Hello and welcome to another lesson on the nature of mass communication. I'm Amrita. In this lesson, we will continue with our study of normative theories. Before we proceed, let us pause and contemplate on the role of the media. What are the most important things that the media should and should not do? What standards of behavior should media practitioners follow as they perform their tasks? Is it okay to do beneficial things by using questionable or unethical means? For example, should reporters deliberately lie or engage in stealing to expose corrupt business practices? What about using a hidden camera to expose a corrupt politician taking a bribe? Or tapping phones to extract crucial information on how deals are being made? Is that ethical, and can that be used in the name of garnering news that is crucial for the country? What do we think of the quality of content that is there today on various reality shows and entertainment programs on television? Should there be some kind of a censor for reality shows? Should reporters be forced to reveal their sources? Would you override national security concern and go ahead and report sensitive matters? Knowingly or not, your decision would be based on normative theory. In today's episode, we shall critically look at the following theories. Understand the role each of them plays and why, as journalists and media practitioners, we need to comprehend the role it plays in our work. The theories we will attempt to understand are social responsibility media theory, the democratic participant media theory, the development media theory, and the agenda setting theory. We will now shift our attention to a normative theory called the social responsibility theory that is predominantly used to guide and legitimize most of the large media in the United States. The social responsibility theory first developed in the 1940s by Robert Maynard Hutchins is still a guiding principle for the media today. The social responsibility media theory emerged as a result of conflict between professionalism and self-regulation of the press and pressure for greater regulation of the media. This conflict mounted throughout World War II and continued during the anti-communist agitation that followed. In response, Henry Luce, the publisher of Time magazine, provided funding for an independent commission to make recommendations concerning the role of the press. The commission members included respected people from many areas of society, including academics, politicians, and heads of social groups. This commission was referred to as the Hutchins Commission, or Freedom of the Press, and was established in 1942. The commission released its report finally in 1947. However, the commission members were sharply divided between those who held strongly libertarian views and those who felt some form of press regulation was imperative. Press regulation advocates argued that anti-democratic powers can easily subvert the marketplace of ideas and use the media to transmit propaganda to fuel hatred for their own advantages. Many of these supporters of regulation were guided by notions about public communication, developed by social researchers at the University of Chicago, the Chicago School. The Chicago School opposed the marketplace of ideas notion and argued that unregulated mass media inevitably serves the interests and tastes of large or socially dominant groups. On the other hand, small, weak, pluralistic groups would be either run down or neglected. This perspective also held that ruthless elites could use the media as a means of gaining personal power and political power. these demagogues could manipulate the media to transmit propaganda to fuel hatred and fear among the majority and unite them against minorities. An example of this is how Hitler used the media against the Jews. At the same time, the Hutchins Commission members also opposed any direct form of press regulation. They realize that placing the media under a control or regulation will hinder the freedom of the press and open the door to official control of the media. This would take them back to the very thing they were trying to prevent. Ultimately, the commission members, after much deliberation, decided to place their faith in media practitioners and called on them to redouble their efforts to serve the public. The majority members wrote a lengthy report to provide guidance to media practitioners, reminding them that they have a certain commitment to society. These obligations were expressed in the words informative, truth, accuracy, objectivity, and balance. The social responsibility theory states that the media can be used by anyone who has an idea to express, but they are forbidden to invade private rights or disrupt social structures. It emphasizes the freedom of the press and places responsibility on the media practitioners to abide by certain social standards. It opposes media regulation but believes that the press is automatically controlled by community opinion, consumer protest, and professional ethics. It calls on the media to be responsible for fostering productive and creative great communities. It says that the media should do this by prioritizing cultural pluralism and by becoming the voice of all the people. In other words, the media should not just voice the aspirations and concerns of elite groups and groups that had dominated national, regional, or local culture in the past. It should pay attention to the interest of all in society. The report also points out that the media, in carrying out their obligations, must adhere to the highest ethical standards. By paying attention to pluralistic groups, the media were building a wall to protect democracy from external and internal assaults. The basic principles of the social responsibility theory were summarized by Dennis McQuill in 1987. The media should accept and fulfill certain obligations to society. The media should serve the political system by making information, discussion, and consideration of public affairs generally accessible. The media should avoid whatever might lead to crime, violence, or civil disorder or offend minority groups. The media as a whole should be pluralistic and reflect the diversity of their society, giving access to various points of view and to rights of reply. Journalists and media professionals should be accountable to society as well as to the employers in the market. The media has to protect the rights of the individual by acting as a watchdog over the government. The media has to serve the economic system. For instance, by bringing together buyers and sellers through the medium of advertising. The media has to provide good entertainment, whatever good may mean in the culture at any point in time. The media has to preserve financial autonomy in order not to become dependent on special interests and influences. In accepting and applying these obligations, the media should be self-regulating within the framework of law and established institutions. Another normative theory, the democratic participant media theory, advocates media support for cultural pluralism at a grassroots level. It argued that the media are to be used to stimulate and empower pluralistic groups. Unlike the social responsibility theory, which assumes that mass media can perform this function, democratic participant theory calls for development of innovative small media that can be directly controlled by group members for performing this purpose. If group members cannot afford such media, then government subsidies should be provided to them. Existing small media should be identified and funded. Also, training programs should be established to teach group members how to operate small media. In other words, the theory is primarily a reaction against commercialization and monopolies in privately controlled mass media and against bureaucratization in public broadcasting. This step will ensure easy media access to all potential users and consumers. The democratic participant theory supports and emphasizes the importance of the following. There has to be multiplicity of the media. The media should have a small scale or local nature. The media should be deinstitutionalized. There has to be a reciprocal role between the communicator and the recipient. There has to be horizontal communication and interaction and involvement between broadcaster and receiver. The theory reflects disappointment with the libertarian and social responsibility theories for failing to deliver social benefits expected of them. It condemns the commercialization and monopolization of private-owned media and the concentration and bureaucratization of the government-owned media. It also criticizes the public media for being too elitist, too susceptible to the whims and caprices of the government, too rigid and too slavish to professional ideals at the expense of social responsibility. It therefore calls for greater attention of the media to the needs, interests, and aspirations of the receiver in a political society. It calls for pluralism in the place of monopolization, decentralization, and localization in the place of centralism. Also, that media conglomerates be replaced or mixed with small-scale media enterprises. It also calls for horizontal in place of top-to-down communication to ensure feedback and complete communication circuit. Macwell summarized the basic principles of the democratic participant media theory. Individuals and minority groups should be able to enforce their claim to not only the right of access to the media, but also the right to have their needs served by the media. The organization of the media and the content of messages should not be influenced by political or bureaucratic control. The existence of the media must be justified in terms of the needs and interests of recipients, and not exclusively in terms of those of the media organizations, media professionals, or advertisers. Groups, organizations, and small communities should have their own media. In fact, small-scale, interactive, and participatory forms of media are more useful than large-scale, unidirectional media which are used only by media professionals. It argues that social needs are neglected by established media. The practical realization of this theory is encountered primarily in developed societies. On the other hand, some developing countries advocate the use of the national media to promote government-set national goals and promote particular forms of cultural identity. Advocates of the development media theory encourage media support for an existing political regime and its efforts to bring about national economic development. The most important principle of the development theory of the media is the emphasis on economic development. Media liberties should be made secondary to the attainment of these ideals in this view. It argues that until a nation is well established and its financial development well underway, media must be supportive rather than critical of the government. Journalists must not tear apart government efforts to promote development, but rather assist the government in implementing such policies. The duty of the press practicing this theory is to promote development. It also emphasizes grassroots participation. The primary tenets of this theory are: the media must accept and carry out positive development tasks in line with the nationally established policy. The state should restrict the media if economic interests and the development needs of society are at stake. Media should give priority to content that promotes national, cultural, and language matters. Media should give priority to news and information about other developing countries that are geographically, culturally, or politically similar to one another. Journalists and other media workers have responsibilities as well as liberties in their information gathering and dissemination tasks. In the interest of promoting development objectives, the state has a right to intervene in or restrict media operation. Devices of censorship, subsidy, and direct control can be hence justified. Let us now look at the theories of media, culture, and society. The theories of media, culture, and society offer rational and insightful analysis of the role of the media in both culture and society. These theories argue that the structure and content of a media system both reflect and create our overall social structure and our individual culture. The agenda-setting theory, one amongst the many theories of media, culture, and society, maintains that the mass media normally determines the issues that are regarded as important at a given time in a given society. If we take 2011 as an example, we have the 2G scam that seemed to take center stage for a while, prompting all of us to raise our voices against the rapid spread of corruption. Anna Hazare and his cleanliness drive dominated the headlines for a few other weeks. Difficulties encountered in reining in the Maoists have sparked debates repeatedly on news channels. Rising prices, honor killings, the war in Iraq, the fall of Hosni Mubarak, the killing of Osama bin Laden have all time and again been brought into our consciousness. The matter of how to deal with the threat posed by militants or how to rebuild our relations with Pakistan are some of the concerns that have been often brought into our living rooms. However, of all the issues that could have been aired and examined, only a few became dominant. Only a few were viewed by us as the most important issue facing the country. This is agenda setting. For every news story that the media grafts onto the center stage and public view, there are other issues that are not given much weightage. Hence, the media sets the agenda for the masses. With or without the nomenclature, the idea of agenda setting has been with us since the days of the penny press. Walter Lippmann, in his book Public Opinion, published in 1992, argued that the general masses do not deal directly with their environments as much as they respond to pictures in their heads. These pictures are normally what the media cultivates. We are not equipped to deal with so much subtlety, so much variety, so many permutations and combinations. And although we have to act in that environment, we have to reconstruct it on a simpler model before we can manage it, says Walter Lippmann. Bernard Cohen takes this further, refining Lippmann's idea into the theory of agenda setting without specifically using the term. He writes, "The press is significantly more than a purveyor of information and opinion. It may not be successful much of the time in telling people what to think, but it is stunningly successful in telling its readers what to think about." The intonation being that people's perception of the world is dependent not only on their personal interests, but also greatly on the map that is drawn for them by the media, the writers, publishers, and editors of the papers they read. Cohen's idea became the basis of what we now call the agenda-setting function of the mass media. This was further empirically confirmed by research conducted by Maxwell McCombs and Donald Shaw in 1972. They reasoned their interpretation of agenda setting, arguing that in choosing and displaying news, editors, newsroom staff, and broadcasters play an important part in shaping political reality. Readers learn not only about a given issue, but how much importance to attach to that issue from the amount of information in a news story and its position. The mass media may well determine the important issues. That is, the media may set the agenda of the campaign. During September and October of the 1968 presidential election, as a part of their research, researchers interviewed 100 registered voters who had not yet committed to either candidate. By asking each respondent to outline the key issues as he or she saw them, regardless of what the candidates might be saying at the moment, these researchers were able to identify and rank by importance just what the general population thought were crucial issues facing them. Then these results were compared with a ranking of the time and space accorded to various issues produced by a content analysis of the television news, newspapers, news magazines, and editorial pages available to voters in the area where the study was conducted. The result showed up the power of agenda setting. The media appeared to have exerted a considerable impact on the voters' judgments of what they considered the major issues of the campaign. The correlation between the major item, emphasis on the main campaign issues, carried by the media and voters' independent judgment of what were the important issues were more than 90%. In 1972, McCombs and Shaw wrote, "In short, the data suggests a very strong relationship between the emphasis placed on different campaigns issued by the media and the judgment of voters as to the salience and importance of various campaign topics." This study or research conducted by McCombs and Shaw also, on the flip side, highlighted the strength and limitation of the agenda setting as a theory of media effects. While it clearly points out that there is a vital link between media reports and people's ranking of public issues based on that report, on the negative side, we can see that the logic of agenda setting can be mainly applied to news and campaigns. More important, though, is the question of the actual nature of the relationship between news and its audience. It is a possibility that the public sets the agenda and the media just reinforces it. Though the McCombs and Shaw analysis, like most other early research done on agenda setting, implies causality, meaning that the direction of influence is most always from the media to the public. But on the other hand, many in the media argue that the media only provides what the audience wants. Most newspapers have often stated, "We only give the people what they want." So the direction of agenda setting effect is questioned by some. In fact, Macons himself acknowledged these limitations in the agenda setting idea. To judge the utility of the agenda setting approach, other theorists were inspired to carry on some more research. For example, Shanto Iyengar and Donald Kindler attempted to better the earlier research done by McCombs in a series of experiments published in 1987. Because of the unsolved issue of causality, they lamented agenda setting may be an apt metaphor, but it is no theory. The lack of a theory of media effects has significantly impeded our understanding of how democracy works, they further mooned. To develop the agenda setting theory accurately, they offered a testable agenda setting hypothesis, claiming those problems that receive prominent attention on the national news become the problems the viewing public regards as the nation's most important. Their series of experiments scrutinized agenda setting, the vividness of news reports, the positioning of stories, and what they called priming. With reference to agenda setting, Iyengar and Kindler remarked in 1987, after a series of experiments, that the view of Americans of their society and nation are powerfully shaped by the stories that appear on the evening news. It was found that people who were shown network broadcasts edited to draw attention to a particular problem assigned greater importance to that problem. Interestingly, they gave it more importance than they had won before the experiment began and greater importance than did people assigned to control conditions that emphasize different problems. They also regarded the target problem as more important for the country, cared more about it, believed the government should do more about it, reported stronger feelings about it, and were much more likely to identify it as one of the country's most important problems. With reference to vividness of presentation, Iyengar and Kindler found that dramatic news accounts undermined rather than increased television's agenda setting power. Powerfully presented personal accounts, a staple of contemporary television news, might focus too much attention on the specific situation or individual rather than on the issue at hand. With reference to position of a story, Iyengar and Kindler alleged lead stories had a greater agenda setting effect. Two possible reasons for this result were offered. First, people paid more attention to the stories at the beginning of the news. Also, these were less likely to fall victim to the inevitable interruptions experienced when viewing at home. Second, people accepted the news program's implicit designation of a lead story as most newsworthy. Now we come to priming. This is the idea that even the most literate and enthused citizens cannot mull over all that they know when evaluating complex political issues. Instead, people consider information that come easily to the mind or, as Iyengar and Kindler said, those bits and pieces of political memory that are accessible. With reference to priming, Iyengar and Kindler's research strongly demonstrated that through priming, that is drawing attention to some aspects of political life at the expense of others, television news helps to set the terms by which political judgments are reached and political choices made. Today, in this lesson on the nature of mass communication, we critically looked at various media theories. Understood what various experts felt about it, how it worked, and what it meant to our work. Some of the theories we analyzed today were the social responsibility theory, the democratic participant media theory, development media theory, and the agenda setting theory. That is all we have for today. We hope you have understood what these theories mean, and we'll try and see how these theories work when we look at the news from today. Thank you and goodbye.